Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Four Players Cup. Myself, Toby One, bringing you your live streams for this evening with my wonderful co-commentator, Slash. We are doing a matchup which both of us were not expecting. We're doing DDS versus Counter Logic Gaming here in the round of 64. That is right, they've actually managed to phase up in the round of 64. It's amazing how the grid sometimes happen, but means we get ourselves an awesome game up right now. So let's jump ourselves inside the game and also give a very, very warm welcome to my co-commentator, Slash. This game should be very, very different to our last one.
I am fair to share. For all the people who have been tuning in for the last game, well, it was more or less a display of skill of the Radiant team.
Yeah.
Very impressive. Very impressively done. Not necessarily the best ones of sort. And yeah, they're banning on random stuff because they've already picked before it.
Yeah, so ignore the bans, but at least we can look through the draft a little bit faster. We're going to see Loader's classic Juggernaut, Crystal Maiden support, Bane Enchantress, and Shadow Fiend from DTS.
Oh, that's balls, man! That's balls.
I'm wondering what order this thing was done in.
That's balls to pick Enchantress as well as Shadow Fiend against a Juggernaut, because Juggernaut is just going to completely demolish them with Omni Slash.
Tide Hunter. Tide's gonna make it into the mix as well. Remember, guys, ignore the bans. Seeing like Klink's being banned out. Respect. Beastmaster, Enigma, and Windrunner back on the field again. So CLG, they've got good jungle, they've got good gank ability, they've got good pushing power, they've got a good sidelane solo, and a decent agi carry.
The DTS boys, they're all very, very young. They're all very young, but very talented indeed. Prepare for battle.
We'll just run through very, very quickly who is going to be playing what. So,
the job is pretty funny. What? He had a courier in his stash. And now he's finally just went back to base to release it.
Nice.
Fun stuff.
All right, let's check out who's going to be playing what. So for DTS, Mag is up there on the top lane under the name of M. Mam, I should actually say, because it's got the two exclamation marks behind it. He'll be taking the role as Beastmaster. Looks to be solo top as well. He'll run back down, regenerate his mana, and he'll go back out there later on. Free Winner is the man playing as the Enchantress. In towards the middle lane, we've got Yagami Light. Is that actually how you say his name? Is that actually who the hell he is?
I've no idea.
Because I do not recognize that name for the DTS boys.
Can we just call him Light? No, Light of Heaven, obviously. But
yeah,
just
call him Yaga.
Yaga.
Okay. Yaga. So your name is now Yaga. Congratulations, man. You've now been dubbed by the joined out of streamers. Always Want to Fly. He's a name which a lot of people do know, and he's going to be a tie which everyone's going to know on CLG side. And our last one is Red Star. It is the Shadow Fiend down on the bottom lane. And I think I worked out who that was last night when I broadcast DTS. That's not coming to mind right now, so run very, very quickly through CLG. Miracle going jungle, Enigma up towards the top lane, Aki on the Crystal Maiden. Pycat will be taking the role as Juggernaut this time around, which is going to give Loader the solo mid Lashrak. And that leaves our last one, Shmugalik, taking up the role as Windrunner.
I enjoy it so much whenever you say his name.
Well, because I never say it correctly. It's better than saying smuggling, but we go Shmugalik.
I'm probably not pronouncing it correct either. I think only the Scandinavians are able to do so, but the way you say it just makes it absolutely hilarious.
There's supposed to be a gap in the G, so it's supposed to be like Smuglig or something like that. Or, yeah. Except then you're going to add like a Scandinavian accent to it, which, funnily enough, I don't have.
Surprise.
Yeah, I grew up in Australia. What are we talking about? I got a Scandinavian accent. Bratislava. What? No, wait, that's...
It's a bit unusual, I think, that we are saying Pykett and Juggernaut, not Loader. But on the other hand, Loader is normally taking a solo mid role, and Pykett is a hard carry player, so still works.
It's something which has changed around recently. After Loader came back from his holiday, Pykett has just held on to this hard carry role, where Loader just goes, well, it's cool, I can go the solo mid, but he's more of this mid-game-orientated hero now, where they'll give... like give the hard carry to Pycat. And Pycat's really experienced and really skilled in that role as well.
Yes, I think this Pycat was... his performance was stunning at the International, to say the least. His Faceless Void and his Animage performance were top-notch. And, so I don't think it comes off as much of a surprise. And Loader in his prime time was actually the solo mid-player of SK Gaming.
Mm-hmm.
That's valid. It's valid. Double pull there by DTS on the bot lane from Tide Hunter. By the way, I'm not quite sure about you guys, but in my opinion, Tide Hunter is the coolest Dota 2 hero so far, as implemented wise.
Oh, yes. that's a big call.
He's got a hilarious sound set. I think his model is awesome. Just the fact that he's got, a dead fish in his left hand.
Mm-hmm.
His sound set is awesome. His animations, just everything about him screams awesome.
I still think Drow Ranger, actually, I think Windrunner is... If I want to class like one who would stand out above the rest, Windrunner is going to be pretty much up there for me. Her sound set and her sound interactions are hilarious, and I really, really like her model as well.
I like her model, and I especially like the Windrunner animation of Windrunner, but I think her voice set is not awesome. I just think it just doesn't fit too much.
Oh, well.
We already have one enchanters, you don't need a Windrunner to... have this
annoying there's something about sproinking around the place that just...
Yeah, exactly. It's a bit like that.
It gets you excited, man.
It was trying to go on the Beastmaster, but he's got boots, so... Yeah. How the hell did he even get that far? 5-4-0, okay, that's very impressive, man. Very well done, because if he didn't have boots, he would have died there on the top lane for sure.
I think he saved his money off for it. Like, he hasn't bought, many consumables at all. Unless he bought a crap load of clarities, which he's already used. And we're watching Miracle being a real pain in the ass to him. In the meantime, middle lane is where our first blood's going. I was watching this top lane just push through. But Latrak goes down the middle lane. Took 3 heroes to get him, and they took a lot of damage to do so.
What I didn't understand from Miracle is he didn't use the mono conversion on the catapult. So he actually spent a lot of very, very long time there with conversion hitting it. Instead of just converting. So that was a bit... Maybe he wasn't quite sure if the wave had a catapult or not, which is why I think is the main reason, but top tower is still going to go down very, very fast. And Pykin missing the last hit, which is a bit unusual, but the team still gets some money.
Yeah. It's not as though, the gold is lost. They don't loot the tower and go, hey, sweet, no, we kind of lost it in transit. The dog ate my tower's gold. Doesn't really happen like that. But I think Mag's going to be happy with this. You lose the Tier 1 tower, but CLG don't have the power to push down to the Tier 2 tower right now. Not unless Lotus starts to rotate for that. So right. Beastmaster gets more space, he'll get a little bit more farm up, and it's a lot more riskier for Pycat to be where he is. My blade
is swifter. Basically what Beastmaster's going to do, he's going to try to control the lane close to his tower, because it's otherwise, as you said, it's going to be dangerous for the Juggernaut. Then try to gain level 6 as fast as possible, and then kill the Juggernaut.
Yeah. Because once they got that roar up, then they've got a huge amount of control over any hero they want to initiate on. And you got to remember Bane's ultimate too. When you think about the disabled that can come out from DTS right now, to have the roar as well as the Fiend's Grip, and then you've got Nightmare. You can shut down 3 heroes before the fight even starts.
Wow, I was just checking the levels on the mid lane. Lotus level 4, and Yaga.
We want to find out who that actually is. So for the guys who are currently tuning in, who I know have me on Skype, just start spamming me messages saying it is this person. Any background history, anything like that. Thanks, guys. Love you. The Join Dota crew at hard at work. Hang on, what
looks
the hell's
like
happening
on top?
They're
trying to push the top tower.
Yeah, they're going Juggernaut push style. Now, normally the way CLG plays Juggernaut, they go for more of a damage kind of build on the Juggernaut. But they've got that healing ward up at level 2, which is allowing them to stand their ground right now on the tier 2. So maybe I'm wrong. They do actually have the pushing power to push Beastmaster back to the tier 3.
Not fast enough. I don't think they're fast enough at all. And even if they... I'm not quite sure, but it kind of deprives Juggernaut of his space to farm. The fact that he went phase boots, not power trades, means that he's wants to gank.
Yeah, you see him going right now on Beastmaster, but can't get close enough Enigma.
Boots. It's just boots. It's just so good. The fact that he managed to get an early boot really saved his ass so many times.
Watching the rotation now, DTS bringing 3 heroes up towards the top lane. The same to CLG.
Well,
Enigma!
You are screwed.
He's going the wrong way. The troll doesn't trap, though. But there's one imp that will fly that will get the kill on the top lane with the axes to help out. So the rotation coming just when it was needed. But that's giving him time to loiter in the middle lane to catch up on those levels. Not quite sure if the Bane had to go then as well.
I think, by the way, the new way of playing should have been, which I think only Chinese players are using at the moment. I'm not quite sure about Shadow in Dota 2, but still. Face boots, drum is the new way that all players, currently all Shadow Fiend players in China, are playing the Shadow Fiend this way. Main reason is Pouches is not going to help you that much if you're disabled anyway. Shadowfiend is a hero with no escape mechanism, which means if he's disabled, he's screwed anyway.
Yeah.
But if you've got high movement speed, you might be able to escape. Which is all set up for raises. So face boost drums is currently the one advocated by Burning, by Yafitz, basically by all of the top players at the moment. Everybody's getting face boost drums, which has not been fashionable here with the European players so far, at least.
Every SF we've kind of seen, like, and we don't see many of them, but yeah, I don't think there's a single moment where I've seen them go anything other than treads.
Yeah, treads, BKB, most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
If you've got incredible farm, then Shadow Blade or Dagger in between, but still.
I think, yeah, it's going BKB as well. Like, the Ogre Club's already flying out in the Korea. So for,
exactly,
him, for
yeah.
him,
it's
just...
very, it was the same style of the Chinese players were playing and popularized, but Invis Loader, though.
Yeah,
just
but
be careful, but good. So lucky that they were pulling at the moment.
They just can't do anything about it. Like, Tynette is in the neighborhood, and he's almost up to level... Well, he's on level 6 yet.
They want to kill the courier so bad. They saw the courier. But they can't do much about it.
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to go... Okay, that's suicidal.
They're going to go and always want to fly. Anchor Smash will pop, and in comes Enchantress. Shackle managed to lash both the heroes together. Doesn't buy enough time for Low to get out. The SF rotates out from the lane and gets a last hit there on the Lashrak. They're slowing down Smuggleek. As Red Star's gonna go, one last raise, and Enchantress imps. Fantastic control there from DTS, now making it 4-0 up against CLG.
Yeah, very impressive play there. As I said, they had very ballsy picks, but it's really working out. And I think that one of the main reasons is the Juggernaut hasn't really moved so far, while the people have tried to gank the asset and failed doing it because they were just at a numerical disadvantage.
Mm-hmm. Loader is doing whatever he can to hold this T1 tower up. He does not want SF getting that advantage on the bottom lane.
Well, I don't think that SF would be... Okay,
right.
What
are you
hell?
Doing there?
What the
there
fuck?
There's a stun. Is Loader going to get... No, Power Shot's going to do the job. Smuggleek from the side.
Yeah, that was weird, to say the least. Tidehunter had 300 HP and just walked up the ramp into three enemy heroes.
He wasn't warding or anything. He's got boots and that's basically it. You also want to notice the boots the Beastmaster got. They got early boots and... Oh, hello, Shadowfiend kills off Windrunner on the bottom lane.
Raw.
Oh, no, yeah, it's the Raw, my bad. Meanwhile, in the middle lane, Bane getting initiated on by Loader. And there goes the Fiend's Grip. Going to buy time for free winner just to right-click him down. But in comes Miracle. He's got a black hole right now if he wants to pop it, which he won't want to. The spin out from Pycat will help him get the kill, so they take 2-for-2. Now, they're going to lose a T1 tower on the bottom lane in the meantime.
Fortification popping off and one TP, it's Windrunner, but I don't think that's going to be enough. Because she's on her own, the other three enemy heroes are not there.
She's willing to stop him, just shackling up creep waves, that wasn't intentional.
Do you cheeky Beastmaster. Kill the walks past it. Oh, SF, you don't want to take it? Okay, fine. Fun stuff.
While I'm in the neighborhood, I may as well claim the last hit. But noticing the push on the middle lane. T1 tower goes on the bottom, T1 tower will be traded in the middle lane. CLG, they want to keep this even, or at least, well, even. Tower advantage there's by one at this point.
Ow. Interesting Tidehunter item build, not item or skill, but oh yeah, they're going to come in from behind. Pike has got his out.
Yeah, there should be
a
kill.
Yeah, Tide, you don't have TP, yeah.
Yeah, he can't hide in there. No way he can hide in there. Comes back out again. He's just going to gush, anchor, buying time for Bane, who actually pops Loader in the end. If there's a Nightmare, they've got setup time, and there goes the
he's
Nightmare.
Got he's
free
got
win-
out. He's
free
gonna
winter
be very
is
careful.
Here.
Once Piker comes in, he's going to up the Bane.
Yep, and Beastmaster's here, hurls off the Axis, there goes the ultimate right on Bane, Beastmaster lets off the Roar on Enigma. Free Winter is still here now with a double kill. Pinecat will run away.
Yes, he does.
Slow to start with, Beastmaster doesn't have Axis right now, but two more of those imps will do the job, but now out of mana, can't throw them, Axis will go, one more right click, is it going to be there? The boar's not slowing him down, Pinecat gets back to the tier 1 tower, he will live.
That's a power of face beast and Juggernaut, it's just so good.
That still costs CLG though. Like, you pop the ultimate off and sure, you killed off the bank, great, but...
An important kill and Juggernaut got out. CLG still managed to hold the advantage during that fight.
But we're seeing farm coming up on DT on the Enchantress. Like, now we see a point booster with a bracer as well as having treads. And still having another 500.
She's got a lot of kills. Yeah. Yeah, she's got six. She's 6-for-1 if you haven't realized.
Mm-hmm. And a proper magic wand too. Like, she's just been involved in the fights and... This is actually where, like, the old classic Enchantress...
Bot, Bot, I'm watching bot lane.
But... You actually think Bane's going to go for this? He finds Enigma and just gets, hang on, no, this is not a good place to go. Nightmare. Then again, Tide does have Ravage, so if he wants to pop it for this, it might be worth it. But they just cannot decide who they want to attack. While he's being Nightmare, the Ravage will pop for this one, and there goes also. It's a double Ultimate for this one, but Enigma pops off his to get Smuggling back out again. He's going to limit the Power Shot, goes straight through Bane. The Convergence is too much damage, especially with the Malphite Brain Sapping out Miracle. Roar will pop, and he Nightmares himself, trying to buy some time. But it is not enough. And Windrun hanging in the neighborhood with Pinecats around all things
very
he can.
Impressive play by both sides.
It still
was
ends
very
up with
impressive what, because yep. What I can actually tell you what Bane was trying to do. His plan was, right, what I'm going to do is I sleep the Enigma because his Fiend script, his Malphite is so annoying. So because it can interrupt him even if he casted it beforehand. So and then Fiend's grip the Windrunner, so he couldn't interrupt him. But what CLG then did is Windrunner attacked the Bane, so transferred the Night Ward to him. This way, Bane couldn't ulti anymore without getting interrupted.
Yeah. And of course, if Bane's ulti could remain, I'm interested to see if Bane goes BKB in the end. But it looks like he's just going support, so it'll be Mech as well as Arcane Boots and maybe a Four Star a little bit later.
I always say it's a bit dangerous to say that he's going to go support just because he buys a supportive item. Because sometimes we also see Obsidian Destroyers going for Max, for example.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't necessarily... He's still played as a core hero, because if you're a raw support, you wouldn't have that much farm. Mech costs 2,300 gold, which is a lot. We've had a little bit of a disconnect there at the moment. So.
Yeah, red star disconnects.
Yeah, very important guy as well. Shitofi.
I still want to double check that, because it was the reason why I was just like not even saying anything just then. I kind of wanted to double check the exact roster of DTS. Because I want to know if red star is actually meant to be red star, because I got a funny feeling it is actually Funnic. Because I'm pretty sure it actually is Funnic. So free winner is Goblin. Always want to fly is always want to fly. Then you got Mag in there. Jackal, who is Yagami. And then Red Star is Funnic. So that should be their lineup. I love how somebody thinks you're Russian, Slash.
Yeah, I think that's because I got a cold and my nose is a bit full, so... I have a very nasal sound to my tone. You know, I am definitely not Russian. If I were Russian, I would probably even know what these player nicks were standing for. Sometimes I wish I could understand Russian at least, to listen to Vilad's awesome cast.
Yeah, I would really enjoy listening to Vilad as well. If he actually spoke English to a level where he could broadcast, to a level where it'd be like the same excitement as Russia, but there's just something about the Russian language, the way it pops. I just find that so hilarious. It's just purely entertaining because of the language.
Don't let them hear it.
What? I said that to Vlad's face. It's like man, your language, you could be talking about fungal growth and I would still be entertained because your language is that awesome.
It is pretty good.
Yeah. Everything just pops. Everything's got a bit of panaz to it. It's like, hell yeah. I love the Russian language.
I don't like the item choice in Beast Mode good for Tranquil Boots. Well, I don't really see the point, but whatever. I mean, Beastmaster is one of those guys you can't possibly go wrong with boots and him. Because Face Boots works, Power Treads work, Arcane Boots are very popular among the Asian community, and Boots of Travel if you're going to go hardcore ganking style with many other heroes.
Mm.
So any type of boots really works in Beastmaster.
But considering he's got, like, even phase boots, actually, phase boots give you plus 80 movement speed, and you get 80, plus 80, yep, we got plus 80 on Beastmaster, and phase boots, when they're triggered, give you plus 60. So technically, Beastmaster can dive faster with Tranquil Boots. When you think about it that way, and you get your health back when you're running in. Not much of it, 170 over 10 seconds, but that's still 170 over 10 seconds.
There are certain heroes on which Tranquil Boots are really, really great at the moment. One of them, for example, being Axe. Because normally people tend to get a Ring of Health for him to let him stay in the jungle. But normally you will never finish it off the vanguard because it's just not worth it. You need that dagger early on. And some people would just need the high movement speed from phase boot. So you need high movement speed and you need regen. Mm-hmm. You've got tranquil boots. It kind of takes care of it. It's cheap, it's very effective. And yeah, it's just awesome. On certain heroes, it's very, very good. Same as on VS. VS is very good. I think it's like the choice between phase boots and tranquil boots and VS.
Just going to ask up and see what is wrong. And sometimes, like, when they DC out, it's like, oh, nothing's wrong. He's just like, okay. always want to fly, just being truthful. Harshly truthful. So what's wrong with your player? Well, he's an idiot.
Good to know.
He's trying to work out what Steam is.
Is he?
No, that's...
How amusing.
That would be the level of like idiocy which I'd be expecting if someone was going to call, like, yeah, this guy's an idiot. It's like, so why is he an idiot? He just can't master like connecting to Steam. Yeah.
Awesome. To be honest, then you would call a lot of Chinese players an idiots because they just don't speak English. And they had great trouble with Steam, I can assure you.
Yeah, well, then they had no idea how to
add friends on Steam, and they didn't know they could. There was a party option in Dota 2 either.
Well, Steam never even existed. Steam doesn't exist in China.
Well, you don't have a Chinese language option, yes.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's one of these things which Valve is looking into to try and get, like, Dota distributed to the countries. It's one thing to say we have a game, it's another thing to say we can actually release this game for people to play inside this country. So once they hit that point, then, hey, the world of Dota changes. Miracle.
Well, five people on mid lane, right. I think they want the tower.
It's a push! but they're gonna get counter-pushed, like Pycat's down here on the bottom lane.
Hell's go, okay, yeah, Beastmaster's gonna be down.
They really attack hard and fast. You got to remember the stack as well. Can't believe we actually kind of like half forgot the aura stack they're getting. They got the aura, the presence of the Dark Lord from SF, then the Beastmaster aura, and then Enchanted to it. She had a Centaur as well. So
and you forgot VS. Why was I thinking there was a VS in this game?
Because normally whenever there's a stack, you just instantly think Enchantress, Beastmaster, and Vengeful Spirit.
They're gonna go...
Red Star! Gonna prepare for the ultimate
BKB! And then
BKB!
Oh, this is the
miracle! Oh, he did not deserve that! One race, two race, Smuggling takes a lot of damage, but Red Star does the same. But Enchantress heals him up. And the Wilkins causing issues for CLG to get into position. Power Shot will fly through, hitting on two and a bit of the heroes.
Well, Pikett went lads, so they really want to push. But what do you do if you can't push them yourself?
Mm-hmm. Hey, they've got a Lashrak and a Windrunner and a CM. If you want to nuke waves, you want to push fast, then they've got the combo to do that. But the problem they have right now is the fact that SF managed to complete a BKB already. It was his straight-up second item, and Treads was the first. And he's already pretty big, and they've got to deal with him.
Holy crap.
What?
Holy crap, 96. Minute 15, that's insane.
And then you got 70 for 18 on Pycat. So that's how much they're keeping up. And they're like, yeah, screw it, let's go Roshan. And they've already counter warded. Miracle was down here before. And they've still got the black hole because Miracle died in the last engagement before he even had a chance to pop it. There's no vision of this. And I think DTS have cottoned onto it.
There's smoke. There's smoke.
And the Sentry Ward died a couple of months ago.
For some god unknown reason.
Miracle's gonna get gushed. Where's the Ravage? Oh, great race! Hits four of them up there! Always want to fly, can knock in range of Miracle!
There's a Juggernaut inside!
Yep! Now he's gonna spin up inside the wave. Miracle wants to get into this one. There goes the Ravage, Beastmaster, Roar, and they pop him! But Miracle also do the same. Loader goes down. SF with a BKB, but he's taking too much damage there from Pycat until Pycat is finally held in place there by Bane's Ultimate. He is brought down. Great Shackle there from Smuggler League. On the run back out. The Imp even misses. Less one Power Shot off, killing off the ball. There's a 3-for-2 trade, and Roshan is still not down yet. And I think DTS are thinking, can we do this? No, you cannot. Or maybe with a Centaur. No, you cannot.
Miracle is having a really bad game.
It's not his fault, though. DTS, they targeted him so badly.
Well, this is something. This is just basically what happens if you're playing Enigma. This tends to happen.
He needs something to keep him alive. At this point, he's trying to rush up that mech for CLG.
The thing is,
he needs a bracer.
The first time he died, he had 800 gold. The second time he died, he had 400 gold. Now he's got 200.
Just getting pushed back and back and back. All he needs is one big black hole, and he's looking hunky-dory after that point, but he just cannot get in position for it. And DTS, like, I think they knew it. They were Thieves chasing CLG up into the high ground then, and the second they thought, let's do that, they'll think against that. We've got Roshan here, and that is one hell of a choke point. If Pycat can spin while the black hole's pulling everybody in, and then you got CM, Nova, and Lashrak throwing down Edicts and just stunning everybody else up, that's a harsh combo to stand against. And now we're going again.
But the lineup ensured that they have two BKB piercing disables. They got Fiend's Grip as well as Beastmaster Primal Roar. And they look still going to go for it, and they've got to get it, though.
Well, the Ravage went down, so would you really want to initiate after you've thrown so much beforehand? Like, you got Fiend's Grip down and Ravage is down. It doesn't make life easy for you.
It's just at the moment that in a battle of right clicks, SF is going to completely own the Juggernaut.
Yeah.
The thing is that most of the time he's going to be standing there trying to raise while Juggernaut is next to him, Blade Fury.
What is Juggernaut? Is he actually going to go Battle Fury after this point?
Possible.
Oh, hello. Tide. Well, set with a gush. Enchant's going to come through. That's one of damage down Pike. And he takes so much damage from that. He may as well just buy a hood at this stage.
It's not going to help.
He needs something. He gets Perseverance.
You do know that it's pure damage, right, from Enchantress?
Oh, of course. So, yeah, hood's just like, yeah, that's just like crapping it out.
Yeah, this is why always anti-mages tend to take a lot of damage from the Enchantress.
Maybe that's the reason why I've seen Enchantress disappear. Anti-mage being picked less and less and less, so why go the Enchantress?
She's still incredibly strong. She's basically
one reason to go the Enchantress then.
Yeah, she's one of the best one heroes. Does say something.
Now we're looking in towards that middle lane. Aki's on the move back in there, and Beastmaster. I think Tide just giving a little bit of momentum, throwing down the walls. But they're gonna look towards that tier one tower on the top lane soon. DTS. They need that positioning back. They've lost, well, two tier ones and one tier two. And they managed to claim two tier ones of their own.
It's not too bad. It really isn't, because the SF is getting really, really big very, very fast. Bane's got necessary items as well, but he should go for a BKB. Although, they got two BKB piercing disables as well on the dire side. Juggernaut's Omni Slash, which mini stuns the first target, and Enigma Black Hole, obviously.
Just want to point out, Enigma completes the mech.
Yeah.
Yes.
And just pray he gets a bracer as his next item.
Pray that he don't die, Juggernaut.
Yeah, he just pray that he doesn't die. That's a good thing for Miracle. Just live, Miracle. That's your point. We know so much mana's already been used by SF. Like, he can't do an ultimate combo as well as raise combo right now.
Can't you ever look? Yeah, well, Arcane Boots one type.
No, it still only gives him half, and that's an ulti and one raise. It's not a hell of a lot.
Yeah, he doesn't need too much there. He really, really hurts with the right place already.
He even uses one of the raises early. They want to push through, and looks like we've got a...
Next Arcane Boots. Yep, there we go.
Okay, in that case, we'll just take back everything. Double Arcane Boots now for DTS. So both Titus and Bane.
Both where it would be completely insane, but... They really want to fight this?
Yeah, and Enigma wants it.
If
Enigma
they can
wants
get
it.
One guy out.
There goes the first stun. The shackles are already there. BKB pops off early, but the Omni-Eyed Aldi just rips him apart. SF is gone. Magwan's back out again. Smuggly's got himself another shackle in a couple of moments. And CM dropping the Ultimate. Perfect positioning. Even dropping off the mech for him. Ravage will pop from Tide. Nicely done there. And Loader, there goes the Black Hole. Pulling both in. Bane as well as Enchantress. Bane the first one to go. Enchantress now Malphus done following up, and that is the death of Enchantress. And looks like Loader and Smuggler managed to take care of the straggler up back inside the jungle.
5-0 fight. I think you can't ask for a better fight. SF died, although he popped BKB instantly. I don't know why they just didn't move closer to him, because obviously it's physical damage what Juggernaut is dealing. The slashes he does. It's actually... Okay. Let me put this straight. It's actually magical damage, but it's not affected by magic immunity. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Sort of. Except for the fact, like, it's magic immune, there's magical damage. just how the Omni, the ulti works. So the ulti will go through the immunity.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's simple enough. I understand that.
Yeah, and they don't have Tide Ravage again, so a bit tough. They still popped off their ultis, but they just died one by one. They should have, when SF died, they should have backed out instantly. I think they tried, but yeah, kind of difficult to run away when you have an Enigma.
You are right, though, with what you said before, like the positioning. Like, why SF was by himself. Because Juggernaut can't control that ultimate for people who think, oh yeah, he can just say, just click one hero and just slice him up. If you got multiple heroes there, then they tank up the damage as well, but there was no creep wave, and SF was out in his little lonesome. It was a good opening for Pycat to take. Do I want to? Do I? Oh, yes, okay. Going the way of DDS until recent times, when all of a sudden there was a fall in stock prices. It's the Dota economic crisis, or MAG. I think he was thinking about going unloaded then, and he had support to do it, but... And again, CLG have Vision up there, they've got their own ward up on the high ground.
Aki, okay. Scaring two people away, really?
There goes the roar, now they're gonna turn back in, Axe as well as Imps. Oh, the four-star almost kept him up! Now, free winner, trying to run away with that heal, and Omniite Ultimate will jump itself around, but it's enough damage on the last slice. In the end, you got to say Enchant was a little bit unlucky. The Pycat jumped back to him and didn't jump forward to the rest of his supports. And what a shackle! Smoogalig's on the mark. The creep wave's there to help out. Power shot actually misses completely. Four staff down again. And looks like, yeah, that's going to mop up the rest of the... well, are they going to go back in again? DTS? No, they're just pushing the creep wave.
Yeah, I wouldn't call it pushing. Just finishing it off. And looks like he's not going to go for... He's going to go for Necromunicum. As in Bane in the moment.
I'm guessing your brain is thinking about a certain hero right now.
Yes, indeed.
So Necro book for him.
Enchantress nearly's got Axe Stick. Wow, that's one tanky, fat Enchantress.
It's taken her a while to get there, though. Like, after her first set of kills, has she died a couple of times? Like, we've got, yeah, 8 for 3. So she's fallen behind a little bit, but look at the farm on Red Star. 169 CS with 3 for 2.
Yeah, I know, it's insane. It's it's Shadow Fiend. It's just one of the fastest farmers in the whole game.
But just to be that far ahead, like you're that far ahead of Pycat. But Pycat's 7 for 1, so there's his advantage. But
yeah, as in Pycat wasn't really farming.
Yeah.
As in, he didn't place his emphasis on farming.
Well, so it's like trying to go a Battle Fury as the first time. Then it's like, yes, he's putting his emphasis on farming, but he went phase boost and then to Vlad's. With the magic wand and poor man shield before he went anything else. And he's still holding on to that Aegis too. We haven't had a single moment where CLG have a possibility where Juggernaut could lose that.
Most of the time because they couldn't find a way to kill him. I think it was a bit surprising that not a single time they used the ulti on Blade Fury. Because Bane could just hold him there in Blade Fury. Goes through it. So, but they didn't do it a single time, neither the Beastmaster. Like, well, I think what they should have done is just ulti him and SF hitting him to death during that period, because it's more than enough time to do so. Juggernaut has got 1k HP, it's not a lot.
Or do they look at it this way, like, if you do that much initiation on Juggernaut to start with, how do you kill him twice over when he's got the Aegis? Maybe that's where the hesitation from DTS is coming out of.
We have to look as well. Okay, Enigma is actually getting close to his BKB. The fact that he didn't die in the last couple of fights really helped him.
Yeah, he's bought up most of it. It's just the recipe which is remaining, and that's only 1,100 gold away. That's actually really nicely done. That we've got Windrunner now with an ultimate orb, as well as having a cloak, but I don't think he's going to do much more with that. I think he's just wanting that sheep stick. Loader's got his axe.
It's smock time.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
Who are they going to kill?
I don't know, but the Enchanters just got it from the courier, so I think they will fall back and then smoke up. Oh, they want to creep first. Fine.
Where's that toughness aura? Manta up on SF. So BKB Manta 26 minutes in.
As I said, right click. Don't even try to use the ultimate too much.
And Enchantress has that full Agon Imceptor done as well. How much money can you claim from all of this? It's ridiculous. It is so ridiculous. Like, the gold rush should be heading back up again because the SF, but CLG are keeping it below 3k their way. But the next team fight's going to change that up.
That SF just deals so much damage. Do something with it, bro. 120
plus 216. That's how much damage is it per? So attack speed. So it's actually 242 attack speed. So 0.7 seconds it takes him to kick off one. And the attack damage is 219. Movement speed 401.
And
that's not even when he's in range of the drums of Beastmaster. Yeah. This is a weird position because it feels like CLG actually control. But this SF is an unstable element.
What do you mean? If he goes down in the fight early?
Yeah. then DTS have got nothing. But if DTS keep him up, oh, Shackle, it doesn't latch. The Smuggling with that 4-star, he's always there trying to look for an opening. But yeah, if SF goes down, then CLG should take the fight. And that's at the start of it, though. But if SF stays up and he gets a good ultimate and has some good time to right-click, then it's a completely different story. And now here's their opportunity. Roshan's back up again. Yep, they've got a ward watching it.
What's happening.
And is that what the smoke was... Yeah, that's what the smoke was waiting for.
Schmock.
Is there counter... No, there's no counter warding up right now. Mag is the only one that's actually not inside the smoke, and now there's an invis rune for him if he wants to take it.
Oh, they're going
to
run up.
Pycat goes in. Gosh, just started. He's going to pop the ultimate, but he wasn't expecting this many people here. Mana style pops, so it takes up more of the damage. There goes the spin. Starting to go. Miracle wants to come down. He wants to get off his ultimate, but there goes the roar, and he has to go down the SF ultimate. Aki sanded ground with the CM ultimate. It's not going up. Enchanted's only just living. Power shot will not kill him, and the neutral kills him off during the fight. CLG retreat back with 4-star, load up, might be lucky enough, he is going to be lucky enough to get away.
Oh, you bloody crap, that Bane. He just didn't want to ulti. That was, to say the least, very weird.
But they do still take the fight, and they didn't give a single kill to CLG. Enchantress died, but she died to the Ancients, of all things. Shackle-lash Pycat. The vision from the power shot, and then shackling up, but Pycat can't go. Roshan's almost dead, Smuggling's gonna come back in.
He's gonna try to see the Aegis.
Spin's gonna start it off, and Roshan is killed by the Radiant, and Juggernaut picks up the Aegis. Mag will go down, and Redstart's gonna take a fall as well. Ravage to come through. Aegis smash, Loader taking up too much damage. Yami, he finally puts a Nightmare holding Pycat in place so they can kill off Loader. They're gonna go in there to bang him in the Roche Pit, but what a stun! Now the Lightning, they're gonna get the Gush off, but Juggernaut gets a double kill. About to become a triple. If Miracle can get in range for one last stun, he says, screw it, I'm gonna spin, they'll get the kill. Always wanna fly, cannot run from that.
Yeah, well, that Aegis steal doesn't make it again.
Well, he knew he couldn't be interrupted, that was the whole point with the spin. Jump in there with the spin. I'm not going to get the kill on Roshan, but who gives a crap? I grabbed the Aegis.
I don't understand why they didn't get the Aegis faster than him. Because they were three people, so all three of them could have just clicked on the Aegis. And still Parker managed to get it. Well, that's tough. Four people down, that's going to be a tier 3 tower at least.
Yeah, they're going to try and we'll hold it.
Oh, he's got ult, you're there.
And actually the heal from Enchantress, almost
no,
enough.
No, not going to help. Yeah, well, okay. This means it's going to be Rax.
No, I don't think so. Like Mag, okay, now maybe now that Mag has completely suicided himself in, it should be Rax.
One.
And there goes the cancel on the TP, but they've still got fortification, and SF is going to TP himself in close as well. So they're going to look to try and stop Pycat. So there goes the Gush to start with.
One race.
Bane wants. Well, Bane has it in 13 seconds. All he needs is a Nightmare to stall them up and force CLG to engage, but CLG fall back.
The main reason is they were lacking two heroes. Loader wasn't there. Yeah. And when I was there. So in the end, it was a good decision. I thought they might have been closer. But they forced the fortification to pop off, which is a good thing, and got two free kills, basically.
I just don't know why Beastmaster went in there, too. If they fought as four, they probably could have found that kill. They just need that Beastmaster role, but Beastmaster can't initiate by himself. Enchantress kind of had the right idea, change one of the creeps over, try and hold them back for a little bit, but it's... It hits the point where it's like, is there even any point in me going up there? Because I'm just going to die.
I think it's very, very tough. Mainly because Juggernaut always managed to ulti just in time. Just before they tried to focus him. And SF is just... He's got insane amount of farm, but it doesn't seem to make much of a difference at the moment. He popped his ultimate last him on a BKB in Lashrek, so he took zero damage.
It's just one of those times where you want to find yourself an opening. It's like, oh, I've only got a BKB hero next to me. Great, what am I supposed to do? Stuns. They want to try and bring down this tier 2 tower bottom. Bane's going to get the deny. Very nicely done when there's four heroes there. Nightmare to go. Pycat. He's got his ultimate up in 2 seconds, and Ghost Scepter's up, and there goes one race, second race, and now he can pop off that ultimate, but maybe he can't. Ravish to pop, trying to buy them some initiation time. One down so far, Enchantress is there. Loader being held in place. It's all being done by Yaga, but it's not enough damage to kill him. 4 HP, and he gets back out again. Popping up those stick charges to keep himself alive. Actually, no, it's not. Nice shackle onto the dead corpse.
Well, SF bought back, but doesn't have any souls at the moment. Okay, now he does.
He needs a couple. He almost managed to bring down the Enigma.
First shackle, watch for it. Just watch for it, yeah.
What a shackle! SF! They
probably line up with GG.
Always on a fly, yep. GG comes out from DTS.
They were perfectly lined up. I mean, even the blind man could have hit that shackle. I was just saying next to him. He couldn't do too much about it, I have to say, because he was stunned by Malphus. So he was moving at the speed of a snail, basically. A pretty big snail, but...
So just try and get yourself out of position. Well, I'm currently being stunned into one position right now, so getting myself out of position, a little bit more difficult than you'd think. But that's the entire DTS side disconnected by our last one, which is the Bane. But the CLG will get to advance. They'll be going up against the winner of Gosu Style or Brown Stripes in the next round. As far as the next game coming up, I'm checking my graph on the side. It still has to update a little bit more. And then we'll find ourselves the next game for, well, which one we want. The choice is there for us. There is a lot of games to come up. As I said earlier tonight, we are going to keep on going through this until we have all the quarterfinals completed.
And there's some fountain camping here. Well, nice black gold crap. what a troll.
It's all about trying to kill your own teammates.
Yeah. Even in that department, Smoglog is really efficient.
Mm-hmm. They still want a couple more kills before they finish this properly. It's the Omni Slash, which they had up, and then the Shackle. And Pike has still got the Aegis, so he's not going to die. And he even pops the Mantra.
Yep.
And almost got out there.
But he still managed to get his holy shit spree, so yeah. He's going to be happy.
Yeah. Considering he ends the game with 15 for 1 and 167 CS. Then SF's still got 237 CS.
Yeah, but as I said, not put to effect.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the main things. I mean, the Bane was... I just expected a bit more aggressive play maybe from the Bane. Because he did have opportunities. I was clicking on him in a lot of fights. A bit of a shame, really.
Well, maybe in the future they might find the opportunities, but for now, CLG's got the opportunity in the next round. Stick around, boys and girls. We'll be back here with more 4Players Cup action going over the next, well, tonight and then into tomorrow. Don't miss out any of it. Stay tuned, guys. We'll be back soon.